afternoon, everyone. It's still the same study that appears on your booklet, but it just keeps on changing as I send it to my supervisor. So it's gonna be final when I submit the final draft. This is my MSc, and it's focused on wetlands, and I'll be referring to some tools. It might not make sense to some of the people that are not in a wetland field, or they are not really aware of the tools that we use in wetland and some of the assessment that we use. But because of the time, I really have to skip through to most of some stuff. I will try to give as much as I can. You can ask questions or even afterwards. Yeah, this is the structure that I'm gonna follow in trying to present my study. Well, a freshwater ecosystem occupies about 1% of the Earth's surface, and it's one of the threatened and yet most important ecosystem, as it supports a greater part of biodiversity. Globally, the loss of wetlands in the world is estimated at 50%, with some of the countries like Australia, they estimate that they've lost 70% of their wetlands. In America, it's about 90%. And it's not much different when you come back from home here in South Africa, even though there hasn't been a formal study that has been done, but the estimate is that we have lost 50% of our wetlands. And here in KwaZulu-Natal, we've lost about 34 to 50% of our wetlands in the province. And one of the most important reason why our wetlands get degraded and we lose them is due to commercial and subsistence agriculture. Well, the reason for my study was the relationship between wetland integrity and biological diversity is poorly quantified and largely unknown. Yet, agencies like KZN Wildlife, we need the knowledge and we need to know the status and trend of our wetlands so we can make informed decision in achieving our targets. And this study is hope to shed some light in the relationship and the trend of wetland integrity with biodiversity. And probably I would suggest or develop some guidelines in the use of bioindicators in assessment of wetland integrity. I'll be using the word integrity and class and wetland health interchangeably, but it means the same thing. Well, to assess the wetland integrity here in South Africa, we use wet health. It's a tool that is acceptable, and it is a problematic tool in that if this was a wetland community, if I were to ask who can perform the tool confidently, maybe one or two people would raise their hand in a room full of people. So it is a really complicated tool, but it's the best we have, and it's what we use currently. It's not based on bioindicator approach like South African scoring system. Wet health uses the impacts approach that scores the integrity based on the catchment and on-site human activities in a specific site in the wetland itself. And it used the scoring point system, so it's just as like South African scoring system version 5. And this is the table that summarizes wet health. This is the final score you get, and when the wetland is at A, it means it's unmodified, it's in natural condition, and as you go down, it gets more degraded, and the worst score could be F. The aim of this study was to determine the relationship between the response of wetland biota to environmental factors and agricultural impacts in KZN Midlands, to try and cut out some noise that focused on agricultural impacts. The objective was to identify a number of wetlands subjected to a range of agricultural impacts, establish their integrity of each wetland using a wet health tool, and then I will sample all those wetlands with the different taxa, selected taxa for my study. And then I will relate the results of each and every taxa that I've sampled to wet health. The question was which biological taxa to use. First, I went for aquatic macroinvasive rate because they simply well studied and we have South African scoring system which works fine. So it was one of the taxa that I chose. And also I chose dragonflies because Same Ways has done a wonderful job on them, and we have a dragonfly biotic index that is available. So it was one of the taxa that I used. I also use plants, because the knowledge and distribution of plants is well understood and well studied. But this is the last time I'm going to mention plants. I did sample them, but I didn't include, and I won't include them to my final study because I couldn't do the identification because of some problem, so I just left them out. And then I also sampled the water quality. This was my study area. I won't say much, and I was hoping there would be a pointer just to point, because I think it's not really a good... What is this one? Oh, yeah. Oh, this is my study area around here. And I didn't put much of the information, because when I tried to do the dry run, I exceeded the time by like 10, 15 minutes. So it's just to show all my wetlands are around Pietermaritzburg, and the furthest is in Underberg and Kemberg. Okay, the materialism method, how I selected my wetlands, they had to be within an hour's drive from Pietermaritzburg just for cost effectiveness. And I have to use the same hydrogeomorphic type, because different hydrometric types support different animals. And then they have to be in a similar bioclimatic and geological characteristic. That's why they're close together around Pietermaritzburg. And I used the small to medium size wetland, up to 130 hectares. And they have to be impacted with different agricultural activities. Well, to determine wet health, it was done by specialists. It's either I was with the specialist, or they were done by them. But with the difficult and expensive of consultants, I had to use some of the data that they've already sampled, that was already available. And then I did a few with my supervisor. And we stick to the same hydrogeomorphic units. And I used three well health classes. I used A, C, and D. And I used three replicates per each class at least. To sample macroinvertebrates, I used South African scoring system. It was developed to be used in rivers, but Rebecca Bout developed a protocol that could be used in wetlands, so I followed that. You simply need a square frame sweep net with a 23.5 centimeter mouth with an 18 micrometer mesh to sample your thinging. And then I sampled at the top, bottom, and then at the exit point in the wetland, the bottom side of the bottom end of the wetland, and then I sum up all those invertebrates to come up with one site score. Dragonflies, I sampled adult male dragonflies because they territorial, they hang around open waters. I did cover all of the wetland, but I concentrated on open waters because that's where you find most of the adult male dragonflies. You sample for 1 hour by two people, and you catch and identify and release them, but I did keep some specimen. I used the same ways identification protocol. And for environmental variables, I recorded pH, water temperature, electricity conductivity, and total dissolved oxygen. I collected water sample in a half a liter bottle and submerged them in a cooler box and transported them to Umgeni laboratories to do the analysis. The water was tested for ammonia, nitrate, sulfate, and phosphate because I was looking at agricultural activities. My results, these are the most promising one that I will spend most of my time referring to, because some of them didn't work that nice. This was the DPI scores of the dragonflies. As you can see, as the letters on top of the bar graph are your health scores of each wetland. And as you can see, they decrease with DPI scores decrease with decreasing health of a wetland. And the DPI score graph of the prime results showed that there was a clear significant difference between wet health A and D in terms of dragonflies, but there was not really a clear difference between A and C and C and D. And the dragonfly community conservation composition show that the groups wetlands that are in category D, you can easily group them together, and also the ones at C. The ones at A, they were two different ones. And the reason for this was a group wetlands that are in held category A and B together to form one class, which is A. And frogs, I had problems recording frogs because I used my cell phones, because the instrument to record frogs properly is expensive. So I used my cell phone, and there were some difficulty in identifying some of the species because of the ambient noise that was recorded by my cell phone. Macroinvertebrates, there was really no clear differences between the wetland classes in terms of macroinvertebrates. Even the star score between the wetlands were not that different. There was no significant difference between the different classes. This is the water quality. I would just like to draw your attention to the ones that I've highlighted in red because of time. This is the top part of the wetland where I recorded 2,861 micrograms per liter of phosphate. And by the end, it was at the end exit point, it was 426. And this is the wetland at Kembeck in Nature Reserve, which is at A, meaning it's in pristine condition in terms of when you assess it using wet health. These are the physical and chemical parameters of a principal component analysis. I'll just explain this so that I will skip through because I'm running out of time. Wetland vegetation became the most important driver in PC1. It explained most of the difference. It contributed 90% of the difference. So wetland vegetation was most important driver in the different wetland classes. And in PCA2, it was the area, the size of the wetland. And in PCA3, I think it was water depth. And there's two of the dragonfly species that were found in all wetlands, and which those show that they are not good. They can never be used as a indicator of as a bioindicator of wetlands, because they were found in all wetlands sampled. And the DPI scores decrease with the decreasing wild health integrity. The significant difference between DPI score in class A and D was there was a significant difference, and the study suggests that with more work that needs to be done to just in a bigger scope, to it suggests that DPI scores have the potential to be used as bioindicators of wetlands. Ivanhoe Wetland, Community Wetland, which is A, and Ivanhoe Wetland Farm, which is C, have the higher DPI scores at 2.1, higher than the ones that wet health categorized them as pristine. Because these two wetlands, the other one was categorized in C. Ivanhoe Community Wetland, which is in A, I grouped it with the others in A, but it was in group B. So it shows the weakness of wet health, that because it relies on the expertise of the one assessing the wetland. There's a lot of room for different scores. You can reach to a different score differently if you assess the same wetland, depending, and also you can even come up with different scores with using the same tool. So that's another shortfall of wet health. But there was a clear separation ordination space between the wet health classes. There was no relationship between the frog species richness and wild health class, but before those could be ruled out, I think the best available equipment to record frogs should be used. I'm just going to rush through now. And
carry on, finish.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay. There was no significant relationship between the SAR score and wild health classes. However, Class A wetlands had low species richness than Class D wetlands. What I found was in the degraded wetlands with added nutrients, you'd find a lot of different low-scoring macroinverts. But in pristine, you'll find few good scoring. But when you add the score, they end up canceling each other. So I do believe that we could maybe score macro inverts in wetlands differently from the way they score them in SARS, because it was derived for rivers. But this study suggests that we cannot use them as a bioindicator of wetlands. However, the sample analysis clearly showed that there was 60% dissimilarity between the wetland classes in terms of macroinvertebrates. So it shows that there is something there in terms of macroinvertebrates, because they were different, but in terms of SARS scoring, summing up the score, they end up canceling each other. So we do need to develop a SARS-5 equivalent for wetlands and score the macroinverts differently. Well, I'm just skimming through this. You can ask me afterwards to give you more details on them. All the wetlands in class A improved the water quality as the water runs through the wetland. And also, this study highlighted that we do need a bioindicator, because bioindicators respond faster to changes in their habitat. The simple reason that I could give is stellar rest, which wet health classified as in good condition, pristine, in class A. However, there used to be cranes there, and the water quality shows that there is some deterioration taking place, but wet health tool cannot pick that up until it's way too late. So bioindicators are easy to respond to such changes. I've mentioned this so that I could save my time, because I did run out of time earlier. Dragonflies are promising bioindicators, and we need a more bigger and focused study, probably around KZN, to just verify what I've found. Macroinverts are worth further investigation, but with some of the suggestions taken into consideration. Frogs need to be sampled properly before they can be ruled out. What came out of the study is that we do need a bioindicator as an assessment of wetlands, and I do thank you.